Something already on the calendar as opposed to something life changing. And by the way, my life is changing. And if you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, yours is too. But I'm afraid sometimes we can get used to the idea, and how sad for us. Relationships are not fixed and then cease to grow. Relationships should what? Be growing. And if they're not, then we need to do everything on our part. We can't do everything, but everything on our part to do what we can. Who took the lead in having a relationship with you from heaven? We didn't reach up to heaven. God reached down to us, amen? And not only reached down, but came down. And endured the worst that the earth has to offer for our sake. And so he's doing everything he can on his part. And we want to look at some of that. Before we get into that, this is going to be out in the... This is the proper word, vestibule. How many of y'all didn't think I knew a word with that many syllables? After Hieronymus, I was pretty much done for most of my life with a lot of syllables in a word. But anyway, this is about a motorcycle, Christian motorcycle rally that is going to be from Thursday, May the 4th, all the way to Sunday. And there are many, many different opportunities. It's going to be located in... Let's see, this is West Cal Event Center, so that's going to be Sulphur.
That's for the, just for the Sulphur, West Cal.
Okay.
It's at the Heritage. It's downtown Sulphur.
Okay.
It's the Grove. It's called the Grove.
If you're a motorcycle enthusiast or support that ministry, talk to these two people right here on this road.
Cross.
Say again.
Motorcycle Cross, Saturday, coming from Benjamin all the way to Sulphur.
Wonderful. Okay.
They're going to take all three lanes. And Saturday, there'll be free
healthcare for guys. Healthcare is important for motorcycle riders.
And free food.
And free food. But anyway, we're excited about that ministry. We'll have this out there. And if you want a copy of it, we'll run you a copy real quick so that you can enjoy that. And thank you for being a part of that ministry. I know every Friday night, they have a rally at the Seawall in Lake Charles. And so... really important. Well, what place does God get the word out? Every legitimate way possible. And I can tell you, if you're a motorbike rider or a rodeo rider or something like that, you need to stay close to God. Amen? Airplane pilots, those kind of things. Or a parent. What we want to talk about today is what about the week after the resurrection? What about the week after? What should we do and what should we see? And how much of it should we seek to understand? Because if we don't, we'll go through life like people that don't know God. And if we go through life like that, then how will they find out about God? Whose job is to tell people, this is real. This is not some quaint little thing we do on Sunday morning. This is life and death. In fact, it's bigger than death. And it's all about life, amen? Bigger than death and all about life. So it's pretty important. So, let's talk about the next week. Luke chapter 24. I thought I edited some of that out, but apparently I did. Let's start right here. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and other women with them who told these things to the apostles. What did they tell? They said the tomb was empty. We talked about that at our sunrise service. We talked about it again in our regular service, and I hope that we never stop talking about it. The tomb was empty. Wouldn't it be great if graveyards were only just a place to go and think for a minute, but there's nothing left there? Empty tombs. Don't have to worry about getting them bigger. Just keep using the same ones that they got because they won't be held very long. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Let me ask you something. How many graveyards will be in heaven? Zero. Amen? And that's why the Bible says that we grieve not as those that don't believe there's a God, as pagans do. We grieve not the same way because we recognize that it's not about the body. The spirit is gone. The body goes back to that. We were studying Genesis at Brother Matt's every other Friday night. The body came out of dirt, and that dirt goes back. But what lives on forever? Our spirit. And then God says that he gives us a new body that can last for eternity. I don't think it'll be made out of dirt. Amen? It's going to last for eternity. And it will be perfect. Can you imagine, just for a moment, not having to take care of your body? How many of you notice that when we were 37 and whatever, 39, whatever the ages were that we talked about, that you got to take more care of your body because it's not taking care of you the same way anymore? Wouldn't it be great not to have to worry about how many hours a day could we? And just think, no need for mirrors. Wouldn't that be wonderful? I don't know about yours. Mine appears broken a little more every day when I look in. It's not quite the same. But anyway, they went there. The tomb was empty. And the words seemed to be like idle tales, it says. The words seemed to be like, in other words, these ladies were hysterical. This is wishful thinking. This is whatever. That's kind of what it came out. Why? Because, you know, we know how the rest of the book goes. And we say, oh, those poor, precious ladies, I don't know what they would think. They were beside us. Listen, in that day, could they think or hope of more than all we know is it's empty? Then Peter arose and ran to the tomb. We know somebody outran him. How do we know that? John just kind of slipped that in there into his telling of the gospel. Yeah, he was Jesus' favorite, according to him, the disciple that Jesus loved. Now, which disciple did Jesus not love? He loved them all. All of them didn't love him. We know Judas didn't love him back. But he loved them all, didn't he? But isn't it great that God can make you singularly feel loved? And especially if you look at the evidence of what all he's done so that we could be here and have a future. But he arose, ran to the tombs, stooping down. He saw the linen coffins, the cloths lying by themselves, and he departed. Isn't that interesting? If there had been grave robbers, do you think that they would stop and say, well, let's carefully take these cloths off of Jesus as we take the body? Nobody's looking. Those armed guards out front, don't pay no attention to the armed guards or Pilate. All he does is puts people on crosses and stuff. We don't have to worry about that. Let's stop and very carefully take these cloths off. Just crazy ideas like that. But strangely enough, there were all the cloths lying there. And he departed, marveling to himself what had happened. He saw something amazing that happened. But he still wasn't quite there. He still wasn't quite there. How many of us? No amazing stuff has happened. We're still not quite there. And I'll be honest with you, on this side of eternity, we won't get there. In fact, we won't get there until we get there. Amen? We won't get there until we get there. But we can grow here. That's the word sanctification. Getting more like Christ Jesus. We can grow in that relationship. He marveled to himself what happened. Now behold, two of them, we're talking about disciples, that's followers, we're not talking about apostles, were traveling to that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. So our discussion today is going to be about that road to Emmaus and what took place. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for this amazing grace, Lord, this amazing undeserved favor that you offered each of us. Lord, forgive us for our ignorance and in some cases our chosen ignorance. Forgive us for putting our relationships on cruise control instead of making them the most important things in this life as you did for us. The whole Bible is about your relationship with us and ours with each other. You said all the law and prophets are summed up into that. Lord, we tend to put things or activities ahead of relationships. Lord, help us to center back on who we are and whose we are. I pray, Father, that as we read it here, Father, we recognize that we can get closer and closer and closer to you. And Father, that because of that, we can live different. We can act different. We can be more effective for your kingdom. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Here's two disciples. On Friday, what happened? Jesus was killed. Now listen, Jesus was killed, but he wasn't a victim. We talked about that last week. When they went looking for him, their armed guards and all, they went in the garden, they couldn't find him. Jesus stepped out, said, "Who are you looking for?" Did Jesus know who they were looking for? No. They said, "Jesus of Nazareth," and so they immediately arrested him? No. They fell back. He said, "Guys, who are you looking for?" Now, Jesus wasn't crazy about the idea of the cross, but he was willing to do what? Whatever it takes to rescue those who were in prison. How many of y'all have ever seen those where the special services will go back to Vietnam to rescue the guys out of POW camps? Have you seen those? The special forces will go, and they're amazing heroes because they put their life in danger to go and help someone else, right? Why did we not give Jesus the same status? Because you talk about going into hostile territory, the perfect one who knew no sin came down to a place full of sin, people who live for sin, people who will kill you for your sin or kill you for your not sinning, right? And he came down, and listen, it wasn't that he might get killed in the process. He knew he would get killed in the process, and he said, "I'm in. Sign me up." And he came, and he went through this whole 30-some-odd year experience, mission to do what? To rescue us. He lived a sinless life in a place that had a lot of sin. And then he offered himself. And that's why he stepped out and says, "I'm he." And so immediately they recognized they could trust him. And they said, "Well, come on, let's go up here and have a talk then." No, what did they do? They bound him, beat him, interrogated him, examined him in one place, then to another place, then back, and then to another place, and finally in front of Pilate, and they did all that, and they put him on trial, and what did they find him? Innocent. They found him innocent. Three times Pilate said, "This man is innocent." Herod Antipas said, "I find nothing wrong with this man." The captain, as he watched Jesus die, said, "Truly, this man was innocent." And so they executed him. If you think our justice system is messed up, look at that. Right? What was his sentence? What was his sentence for being innocent? Death. And they carried it out. So all of that took place. And then, do you remember Joseph Arimathea loaned him a grave? Wasn't going to need it long. And he had, others went and anointed his body, and they wrapped him and got him ready, and they put him in the grave. And then they had the stone rolled in front, and then the priests and all who had conspired. Do you want holy people to go in the back room and conspire to kill someone because it makes them look bad? Or because it doesn't match the political realities of the day? That's what they did. In fact, if you remember, when Judas brought his money back, says, "I don't want this anymore." And they're holding the money that they gave Judas to have Jesus killed. And they said, "Oh, well, we can't keep this. This is blood money." Who paid the blood money? They did. Crazy stuff. Crazy stuff. Right? Anyway, all this is going on. And they're back at home on the Sabbath, on the Saturday. Nothing they can do but early Sunday morning. Who's first to get over there? The ladies. Now, this is kind of strange, too. Ladies weren't considered in high esteem as far as a witness goes at the time. But yet, who did God allow to be the first? Who were the first witnesses? And we just read, did they take their word for it? These silly, emotional ladies. I didn't say that. This is kind of the impression they get, right? But who does God hold in esteem? They were there first. And what happened? So the guys went in to say, "Let's be sure this is true." And they went in there and checked it out and said, "Yep, keep going. Turn around with that." Kind of the end of the story. There wasn't a whole lot going on that day. And some of them even left town. And these two guys are walking to Emmaus. I say, guys, one, some people hold it is a lady. In fact, they think it might be even his wife. The guy's name is Cleopas. But there's another place that says Clopas, his wife, or his girl, or mom, or daughter, or whatever, Clopas is married, was there at the tomb that morning. So that's possible because you know what the Bible says? It doesn't matter. Gentile or Jew, Jew or Gentile, it doesn't matter. Male or female, it doesn't matter. Slave or free, it doesn't matter. God holds us all where? Equal status. mankind comes up with all these different things. Amen? So anyway, they're leaving, and they're going 7 miles. How many of y'all walked 7 miles to church this morning? Nobody? Me either. Okay? I live a block away, and I drove twice, in fact, you know? Anyway, because I forgot something. Anyway, 7 miles they came, and as they talked together of all the things that had happened, they're talking going down the road. Well, I can't believe that that happened. We followed Jesus. They're disciples. They followed Jesus. That's what a follower is. They weren't apostles. They were disciples. Everything was going well last Sunday. You know, it was Palm Sunday, and Jesus went in. He kind of went in and told them in the temple, don't play any more church games here. It's not about the money and all that. It's about, it's supposed to be a place where he cleaned it out again. That wasn't the first time. And he went through it, and they tried to corn him with questions and stuff, and he'd give them answers. He'd ask them questions they couldn't answer. I mean, he went on through all that. He went through the trial, found innocent and all that, and then they killed him. This one who we left our home to come and follow. And now we don't know what's going to happen. And to make matters worse, the tomb's empty. What does that mean? You know, what does that mean? So they're talking about it going home. So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. Oh boy. Now they have affirmation, confirmation, proof that Jesus beat death, right? Wrong. But their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. Jesus didn't let them know at that point who he was. Why not? I mean, isn't that what we're here to do, is proclaim Jesus? To show him to everyone? To let others see his reflection in us, and us, in other words, if we could disappear and they see Jesus instead of us, that would be even better, wouldn't it? Because then they would know how to get to heaven. Mm-hmm. They would know personally how to get to heaven. That's the thing, but Jesus hadn't shown that yet. Brother Raylan brought out in the Sunday school lesson this morning that he told them when they first said, "You're the Christ, keep this quiet for a while." Why? One time. Because people react in different ways. How many of you have noticed that? How many people have you tried to tell about Jesus? How did they react? How did they look at you whenever you said, "I got church tomorrow"? I don't know if you've noticed this. There's one or two empty chairs in here. Are people excited to get up and go proclaim Jesus these days in general? What do you think's more full? Carports in this little town that we live in right here, or church chairs? Some of these carports, why is that? Are we not proclaiming the truth? Are we not excited about the truth? Are they scared of the truth? Or they don't believe it's the truth? What is the reason? Now, this, we're not condemning, we're stating facts. Jesus didn't come in the world to condemn the world. That's not our job either. But that the world through him might be saved. And he says, now it's your job. Go tell people the truth so they can get out of that condemnation. So they're already condemned because they haven't. Well, they haven't found Jesus. And Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and the only way to see who? The Father in heaven. The only way to heaven. You say, well, Brother Darrell, that's kind of narrow-minded. Well, let me go ahead and ask you this. Who else died for your sins and was bigger than death? Nobody? Well, that's why I'm narrow-minded. Right? There's nobody else. I can't die for my sins. I would be dead for eternity. Right? And we're talking about a living death, a conscious death away from God. It's a debt that I can't pay. And nobody else can either. They're not qualified. Only one. So listen, narrow-minded. Christians are very narrow-minded, but open-hearted. And that's where people miss the point. People like to say, oh, you're narrow-minded. There's certain things I am very narrow-minded about. How many of you are narrow-minded about who's going to administer drugs to your children? How many of you want the pharmacist and doctor? Or how many of you want the guy on the street corner? Or the bag man in the bushes? I'm narrow-minded about who's going to administer drugs to my kids, huh? You see what I'm saying? There's certain things it's okay to be narrow. How many of you are narrow-minded about which side of the highway you're going to drive home on today? How many of you are fairly narrow-minded about that? How many are you narrow-minded about which side the other people coming your way are going to drive on? You see what happens? The enemy twists words so they sound negative, and yet they're very positive. Are you narrow-minded about where the doctor is going to operate on you if he's going to take your appendix out? How many of you want him working on your neck? I'm narrow-minded about it. I want him working where the appendix is. You understand? So be careful when you hear these terms that get twisted enough. Christians are narrow-minded. But if we're going to be like Christ, we're going to be open-hearted. Amen? Their eyes were restrained. They didn't know him. It wasn't time yet. He had more to teach them. And he was going to be able to teach them more, and they were going to be able to receive more whenever the perfect time for that revelation was. And he said to them, what kind of conversation is it that you have with one another as you walk? And they're sad. They're sad. Their hopes were set on Jesus doing what? What's going to tell us shortly doing what? But they're sad. Now, it's kind of like when God went to Adam and Eve in the garden. He says, where are you? How many of you have kids or grandkids? They like to play hide and seek. You can see them giggling behind the chair as they're waiting for you to get home. And so you say, there, I see you back there. What do you do? You don't say that. What do you say? You say, where are you? Right? And you join in the game. Well, it wasn't a game that day. Could God know where Adam and Eve were? Absolutely. He was asking a much bigger question than that, wasn't it? Where are you spiritually? Where are you in our relationship? All of those kind of things were there. And he was trying to let them tell. And all they did was make excuses, not like any of us. Anyway, he says, okay, where are you guys? What are you talking about as you travel? Then the one whose name was Cleophas. And by the way, this is the book of John where it says Clophas. And his Mary was there to him. But this Cleophas answered and said to him, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which happened there in these days? Do you not know? How many of us know that we live in a culture that really don't know about Jesus anymore? Some have had bad church experiences, and they don't want to know anymore. That happens. You know the kind of people that go to church? People with problems. How many of y'all know people that go to church and they got problems of their own? How many know people that go to church that have a problem with sin? How many of you only want to go to church where there's perfect people? No such thing, amen? And you know what? We get on each other's nerves. It's a good thing God keeps going over that forgiveness thing. Why'd you have to keep throwing that thing out there? Because we're imperfect people seeking to serve a perfect God. Right? And God chooses to work in that. It's not easy. And yet, if we practice the things He says, this forgiveness and this gentleness and joy and love and all those kind of things that He gives us, it's better, but He won't be perfect this side of heaven. How many of you notice we're not in heaven yet? And we shouldn't expect heaven on earth yet, but we can do our best using His tools, using His plan to make it as good as we can get it so others want to come. He says, you don't know what's going on over there? And he said to them, what things? Is Jesus kind of playing with them? Jesus is working with them. Jesus is bringing them to the place that He can explain things. Right? And He can't do that until they recognize where they're at. What things? And so they said to them, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed, and in word before God and all the people. What did they say Jesus was? A prophet. A teller of God's word. A teller of God's word. People say a prophet just tells all about the future. Well, if it's God's word, absolutely they do. But God may be telling about things in the past. How many of us, in Genesis, we're talking about things in the past. Right? But telling forth God's word. They needed prophets back then because they didn't have what? It wasn't written down yet. And so they needed the prophets more and more. But Matt brought out in our men's devotional the other morning, we're all called to be prophets in the true sense of the word, which is telling what? God's word. Not make up stuff, not conjure, not call Cleo on the hotline or whatever. Right? But tell what God's word says. And they said, he's a prophet. Is Jesus a prophet? Yeah, and a lot more than that. Do we live in Jesus? Jesus, we put a little slot there. Let's see, I'll pencil Jesus in for an hour on Sunday. if I choose to keep the appointment, that's on me. Has Jesus ever not been there when you went? In fact, he was where you left from. He says, I will never leave you or forsake you. How many of us miss appointments with Jesus, though? And listen, if you think I'm talking to you, I'm talking to me. In my human state, this side of heaven, I can't always trust my emotions or my reason or lack of. I can't trust any of those things, and I need a compass. I need something that reminds me what true north is, and thank God he gives me his word. So he was these things. He was mighty. He did these things. He validated the word of God. And how the chief priest, even though he was good and innocent and all that, the chief priest and the rulers delivered him to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. Crucified is not a good word. If they said they hanged him, it would probably be a different story to you. Or if they put him in front of a fire squad, it might mean something different. We kind of clean the word crucified up. It was the worst way they could kill somebody. They executed him. Then they tell why they're so sad. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. They were hoping for a political change. Israel was under the domination of the Roman Empire. They had to pay taxes to Rome. It's interesting that God had a tax collector in his close circle. It's interesting there. And he saved others, Zacchaeus. Right? Other tax collectors. It's interesting there. They're looking for a political savior to come in. We were hoping that he would redeem Israel. I think of the word redeeming, and I think about when I was a child and my grandmother saved S&H Greenspan's. Anybody remember S&H Greenspan's? You remember the redemption store? Isn't it neat that you could get redemption in Lake Charles over by where George Terrio's was? There was a redemption store there. But it wasn't spiritual redemption. And what did it mean? Well, if there was a coffee pot up there that you'd been looking for, that sucker was enslaved and sit on that shelf until somebody came and brought the ransom, 13 and a half books of S&H Green stamps, and you could rescue that poor coffee pot from a life of nothing from that top shelf. You redeemed it. That's what it meant. You paid the ransom. Okay. Now, we could be silly about the S&H Green stamps and all that kind of stuff, but that's what redeem meant. A scarier way is if someone is kidnapped. If you bring the money and buy them out of their kidnapped status, they get to go free. Well, it's supposed to work, but you're dealing with criminals. You don't know what's going to happen. And if you don't, they say they're going to kill them. How many of you, if you were kidnapped, would want them to go ahead and bring the redemption money? Absolutely. We'd be kind of excited about that. How would you feel if they said, all right, I don't fit the budget this month. Check back with me next month. We'd be a little concerned about that, wouldn't we? Well, he was saying that he hoped Jesus was going to come and do what? Pay whatever it costs to set Israel back on the highest place again. They could run their own country again. All that kind of stuff. That's what they were looking for, was a political redemption. And that's not what Jesus was bringing. What's the problem with political redemptions? Don't know, even know if the words go together. Yeah, it is temporary. Right? It's very temporary. And it goes back and forth and all that. What about the redemption that Jesus offered? Instead of us being a coffee pot on the shelf with no place, he was going to do what? Take us off the shelf and offer us a future, a purpose. He's going to offer us significance. All of those kind of things. Instead of just a life of existing. And then life everlasting. And it's not temporary, it's what? Eternal. But this is where they were in their minds. Do we kind of put God in a box or religion in a box and that's all we see of it? The song was Open Eyes of My Heart. And the song before that was Amazing Grace. The promise of something so much bigger, totally undeserved. The Bible says that he wants to give us what? More than the eye has seen, the ears heard, and the heart can come up with. That's what he wants to give us. And so what's Jesus trying to do? He's trying to take those limits off of Cleopas and his companion. We were hoping they were going to redeem Israel. Temporarily. Indeed, besides all this, today's the third day since these things happened. Yes, and certain women in our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us. When they did not find his body, they came saying that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. That's what they said they saw. Did it sound like they were convinced that that's what they saw? They're walking home sad. Were they convinced? Where would you be if you were convinced? Look, let's go another route. I'm the pastor here. And so do you believe me when I speak? Some of you Sunday school answers, you might not get. Okay, if I say, okay, I have a little coupon here worth $1 billion. Just write it down. I'm going to put it on the altar. And if I, let's say I put a slip of paper there. And it's for the first one who gets to it. Do you believe me? I don't have to ask you that. I'll know if you believe me by what? Where are you in the next 5 seconds? Right? Where would you be? If I say, yes, I believe you, and you say that you see, then that would be what? Lip service. What does it take to be saved? Confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord. It's over here on the wall, Romans 10:9. Confess with your mouth Jesus is your Lord. If he's your Lord, then I know that, and he knows that by us doing what? Doing our best to do what he says. Lord means boss. Lord means master. Lord means the one that I put in complete authority in my life. Right? And believe in your heart God raised him from the dead. They might have said, he might have got raised from the dead, but if they did, why are they walking home defeated? Verse 2 ahead of that says that salvation is as close as what? The lips and the heart. Because it has to be what? It has to be real, not just some religious chant that we do. He says, by the way, if you confess with your mouth that he's your Lord, believe in your heart God raised from the dead, you will be saved. That's not ambiguous at all, is it? Straight up. There it is. Well, these people are walking home. They heard all these wonderful stories. How many of you would have hung around to see what happened next? If some guy got killed, his grave was empty, and the angel said, don't worry about it. He's alive. Where would you have stayed? I mean, it's not like they were missing many shows on TV, right? They could DVR and watch them next week. Something. Of course, there wasn't much to do back home. And why were they there? They'd been following Jesus for a while. Verse 24. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb, Peter and John, and found it was just as the women had said. Can you believe that? They can believe the women now, because the guy said it was okay. Anyway, just as they said, but him they did not see. They didn't see Jesus. Now Jesus is ready. Oh, foolish ones. Now he's not saying that down. He's just saying, guys, you missed it. You've been fooled. You're believing your limitations instead of believing what actually happened. And you got all the evidence. It's all right there. That's what he says. Oh, foolish ones. And slow of heart to believe. And all the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have sufferings, suffered these things and to enter into his glory? He says, it's already been spoken. You know what it says throughout the Bible, Old Testament. You know what it says. And so shouldn't that be the exact way it happened? You know he's talking about the Word, because look what it says in verse 27. And beginning with Moses, you know, Moses is giving credit for writing the first 5 books. So if you're beginning with Moses, how far back are you going in the Bible? Genesis. Right? The very beginning. In the beginning was God. Who wrote that? Moses. Right? In fact, it wasn't divided into 5 books. It was just 1 book. And when he wrote it, he didn't know that they were going to do all they did to stick numbers on it and all that kind of stuff. But God gave it to him. Right? He did. And the prophets. That's the Old Testament. Moses and the prophets. And that's the only one they had at the time. He said, so beginning with Moses and the prophets, he expounded to them in the scriptures in the things concerning himself. Well, what kind of things did Moses say? How about this one? Chapter 3 of Genesis. And I'll put an enmity. In other words, he's going to put something between the women and snakes. What do you like, ladies, between you and snakes? Distance, generally, huh? A shovel? Okay, anyway. And between your seed and her seed. Now notice her seed is capitalized. When we put a name for our Lord, we capitalize it. He shall bruise your head. He is capitalized. This seed of the woman, and you shall bruise his heel. Talking to the serpent. Best you're going to do is make Jesus uncomfortable. He was. on the cross and looking at some of the things that he's tricked us into doing, and we bought, right? It's just going to make you uncomfortable, but he's going to do what? He's going to put the nail in your coffin. It's going to be it. Where do you want to hit a snake? How many of y'all aim for the tail when you're hitting a snake? Don't do much good. It just makes you mad. Where do you aim? For the head. Okay? This was where? And this is Genesis, and there's Jesus already. How about this one? Isaiah. 700-800 years before Jesus said, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. He shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. Virgins having babies? That don't make sense. This was a type that was going to happen eventually with who? With Mary. How about this one? He, it's at the beginning of the sentence, but it's also putting it there because it is the proper noun for Jesus. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. Jesus didn't go as a victim. He wasn't proclaiming, but I'm innocent. Why are you nailed me to the cross? He knew why he was being nailed to the cross. It was for you and me, right? He opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to slaughter. Now what John is saying about it, behold the Lamb of God. That sacrifice is going to take our penalty for sin on himself, is what he was saying. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers is silent, he did not open his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. We talked about this story last week. This is 700-800 years ahead of time. It's amazing. You could have written this in the newspaper that week after it happened, and it would have read just as precise. In fact, you could trust this. This is not fake news, even though it was 800 years before. Who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of living. Jesus gave up the idea of having an earthly wife and then all that kind of stuff. That wasn't what was important to him. What was important to him was you and I being redeemed. That was his mission. For the transgressions of my people, he was stricken. For my sins, for my going against God, he took the punishment. And they made his grave with the wicked. Who did he die between? The two thieves. There was a good thief and a bad thief, right? No such thing as a good thief. Who wants to live next door to a good thief? You won't have anything when you get home, right? One said, I'm going to treat you as king. Remember me when you come in your kingdom? And the other one said, who are you? One went with Jesus and one did not. He made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death. Remember Joseph Arimathea? Rich man who went and got his body and brought it in because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. And he goes on and he gives the fuller story of all that happened to Jesus, and all this was right before. He says, you could be reading this if you want to. How about Zechariah? This is an interesting one. But I will pour out on the house of David and on all the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication. Then they will look on me whom they have what? Pierced. Hundreds of years before Jesus was born, incarnated, they were going to look on him. And how did they make sure Jesus was dead? When they said he's dead, and the captain says, make sure, what they do? Pierced his side with a sword. I mean, with a spear. And the water and the blood came out. If you go see the case for Christ, they'll talk about what all that meant. But proof of his death. Yes, they will mourn for him as one mourns for his only son, and grieve for him as one grieves for his firstborn. And that's from Zechariah. And there's, countless, but there are many, many places. I've heard from Daniel chapter 7, which we're going to cover tonight. The Lord willing, we'll be here for that. And I'm excited about these last chapters of Daniel, if you can come be with us. We just finished the stories that you're used to hearing in Daniel. Last week was Daniel and the lion's den. Now, what was interesting about Daniel's lion's den is it parallels the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He was thrown to certain death in a hole, and a stone was covered. He had a sympathetic king. Remember, Pilate really didn't want him to go to the cross, but he couldn't stop it from happening. And this king can't stop Daniel from being thrown into the thing. And then early in the morning, what happened? Somebody runs in looking for things happening. Had to roll the stone away. And what did they find when they looked in? Death hadn't gotten him. Parallels Easter. Isn't it strange God allowed us to do that on Easter Sunday? Isn't that strange how that works? But those are the stories you know. You know about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and the fire furnace. You know those kind of things. But it was written in Daniel way back then. It was pointing to who? Jesus. Jesus all through the Old Testament. And so he said, why haven't you seen these things? Oh, foolish one, slow of heart. Believe the prophecies that have been spoken. All Christ not have done this thing. He said, beginning with Moses and the prophets, he said, look in the scriptures. It's always been told you for hundreds of years. I think Nostradamus got a few percentage of his predictions right, and they proclaim him as so wonderful and so wise and all that kind of stuff. He missed way over half. I forget what the number is. It's not that big of a number, but they talk about how much the Bible has never missed. And they try to do what with it? Discredit it all the time. It's really interesting how they do that. Then they drew near to the village which they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone further. He says, I'll keep walking with you guys. They said, no, we're home. And they constrained him, saying, abide with us. Well, then stay with us. For it was toward evening, and the day was spent, and he went in to stay with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took the bread, blessed it, broke it, gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened. If only somebody would write a song about that. Right? Open eyes in my heart. Their eyes were opened and they knew him. And as soon as they knew him, he vanished. Now be careful. People have said, see, that's why we take the sacrament of the breaking of the bread and all that. Well, there are other people who had their eyes open and that didn't happen. Is the Lord's Supper important? If God says, do this in remembrance of me, absolutely. Be careful. Don't read more into it than it says. But look what happened. They realized, wow, there's more to this than we thought. And they knew what? Not only was the tomb empty, Jesus was alive. Death couldn't hold him. In fact, their own consciousness couldn't hold him. Because what did he do as soon as they saw who it was? Disappeared. He's bigger than our rationale. He's bigger than that. And yet, how careful was he to be able to walk with them all those miles? He stepped in. Again, like I told you, we talk to our kids a little different. Why? So that they know that they're loved. And so, knew that they were loved at that point. And they said to one another, did not our hearts burn within us when he talked to us on the road? They didn't know it was Jesus again as he brought the truth out. And he told them, it's always been there. Does God ask you to respond in blind faith? No. He asks you to act on what he's revealed to him. And if you see that that's all lined up, then you can anticipate, if he's never let you down before, why will he let you down tomorrow? Or the next day? Why will he abandon you tomorrow or the next day if he's always been there? And so we have faith based on evidence that he's going to be exactly where he said he would. Right? And now they know that bigger and better than they ever did before. Didn't our hearts burn when he talked? While he opened the scriptures to us. The scriptures weren't some dead language. They were breathing and living and bringing things to fact. So what did they do? So they rose up that very hour and they went to Jerusalem and found the 11 who were gathered there together. And what did they tell them? The Lord is risen and he appeared to Simon. And they told him, he said, we saw him. We saw him. He's there. Now, when did they leave? That hour when Jesus was gone. Now, why did they leave Jerusalem? They were disappointed. Why are they running back 7 miles? Because they're not disappointed anymore. The disappointment's over. They look for a different future now than as they were leaving, right? And no longer instead, how many of us, when we get depressed, we get away from people? What were they doing? They were getting away from the church group, the people who believe like them. And now that they see that things are better, they're running back to them. When do we need each other the most? In the most doubtful, the darkest times, we need each other the most. That's how we bear one another's burdens and those kind of things. We make sure that we don't walk through it alone. But here they go back, and life has changed. Jesus said he would walk with them further. How long has God strived with each of us to have a better relationship? Why did he leave them? Well, we know that he really didn't leave them. We know that his spirit was going to be there. But he gave them what? Proof of everything that they needed to continue their walk. To let them know redemption was happening and it wasn't temporary and it wasn't political. It was eternal and that was loving. Amen.
Here's the question.
Has Jesus ever revealed himself to you? Do you know that the Bible will tell you that you can't know that Jesus is Lord unless the Holy Spirit tells you? Well, who's the Holy Spirit? Go read in the Bible and look up everything with the Spirit. One time it says the Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost, if you're reading the King James, right? Another time it says the Spirit of God. Another time it says the Spirit of the Father. Another time it says the Spirit of Christ. And it's the same Spirit because we believe in how many gods? One. Right? So you won't know that Jesus is who he says. You can hear from people until the Holy Spirit says, that's right. He asked Peter, who do you say that I am? He said, you're the Christ. He says, flesh and blood didn't tell you that. That's direct from God. So you encountered God as you know that Jesus is God. Now, what did you do with that information? Did you say, then I trust him more than I do me. You're now Lord of my life. I believe more than just an empty tomb. I believe that you were raised from the dead and you're alive forevermore. When you do that, the Bible says you're what? Saved. And the Holy Spirit comes to dwell within you. Seals you for eternity. You don't keep your salvation. You don't keep your salvation. He keeps it for you. And he guides you. And he'll walk as far as you'll let him. But he's a gentleman. And when you want to walk alone, he'll back up. His Holy Spirit may give you conviction to turn around and get to where you need to be, but he'll back up. What did he say? Draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. How many of us want a better relationship with God? How many of us want to look on things eternal more than we look on the temporary? How many of us are glad that death is not the final answer? Amen? All of those things are there, all because of what Jesus did. See, you'll find it. Let's seek a closer relationship. Let's dig a little deeper than we ever have, individually with your Savior. And then come together and share. It's important to come and share. If you've never made Jesus your Lord, today is a great day. If you have, and you've settled for the relationship at this level, I implore you, lay that aside and go for a little deeper walk. And then a little deeper walk, because the more you see, the more you'll like. Amen? Let's stand together.